we are finally beginning our study of the Gospel of Mark. We've been going through all the preliminaries, and now we're ready to start getting into this study. We may be here for quite some time, and if you go away and come on back, we may still be in Mark. We'll be here for a little while. Mark's Gospel is incredible. Let me read to you, beginning in verse 1 of the first chapter. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John did baptize in the wilderness and preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea, and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel's hair, and with a girdle of a skin about his loins, and he did eat locusts and wild honey, and preached, saying, There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose. I indeed have baptized you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. What a way to start the gospel, and it is the beginning of the gospel. As we looked at earlier in our preliminary study of Mark, we saw how this was the first of the gospels that was written. We know a little bit about the life of the writer. We're ready to dig in now to what is written. It was the first gospel published throughout the churches. On it, the other synoptic gospels, as they're called, the gospels of Matthew and Luke, were based. This is a tightly written book. It presents the ministry of Jesus Christ very clearly, and it shows the humanity of the Son of God very distinctly. And that is to be expected of this particular gospel. From the end of the first century, there was a certain scholar named Papias, and he told us that Mark had worked for years with the Apostle Peter and wrote his gospel as a collection from the sermons and the memories of Simon Peter Bar-Jonah. Mark begins his gospel in the wilderness of Judea at about 30-ish AD, when there was still living memory in that land of a great star appearing over the city of Bethlehem, the city of Jerusalem being in a great uproar when the Magi appeared from the east looking for a newborn Messiah, the prophesied king of Israel on the throne of David. They remembered the evil king Herod the Great, who slaughtered all the little children of Bethlehem to prevent any such Messiah from one day taking his throne. These things were remembered by the people there in Judea. And if the child had survived, he would now be a full-grown man. And you can believe this was on the thoughts of some people. Pretenders and fakes took advantage of that. They came and went, usually in a bloody slaughter. The Roman Empire was in full possession of the land of Judea, and they ran it with the matchless military strength of their legions, their comparatively just and benevolent civil administration, and their deferment of religious matters to the local populations, as long as Caesar was honored and the peace was kept. Caesar was not much honored in Judea, but the peace was kept, more or less, and the local religion of the Jews was left to run much as it had been ever since the evil King Herod had built the temple there in Jerusalem where Solomon had built one so long before. He was called Herod the Great because of the incredible building programs that he undertook. He had a ruthless and bloody rule, but the temple was his greatest work of all. It was run by a hereditary priesthood. and the office of high priest was now shared between a handful of close aristocratic families. They were the nucleus of the Sadducees that you read about in the Bible, who believed in next to nothing, except for the lucrative racket that they had created running Herod's temple. They helped keep the peace for Caesar, but they also profited from their pretended resistance to Roman rule. The law of Moses was there, and because of that, they refused to accept Roman coins. Roman coins had the face of Caesar on them, and you couldn't have any graven images, so they refused to accept Roman money. That forced the changing of money to official temple currency at an exchange rate that was ruinous to the poor people of the land. It was very lucrative for the families of the high priest and those they paid off. The official temple coins were the only money the priest would accept for the purchase of approved animals for temple sacrifice. You could bring your own spotless lamb or your own turtle doves or whatever, but some blemish would be found by the inspecting priests, and the sacrifice would not be accepted, so the poor of the land were forced to purchase officially approved sacrificial animals with officially approved coinage, and they were making money hand over fist. You see, without the blood sacrifice on the temple, expected of every family for the remission of their sins, there was no remission of sins. And this weighed very heavy on the hearts of the people, particularly if they were devout at all, much heavier on their hard and difficult lives than it was ever meant to. Many of the poor in the countryside who could not afford what would be hundreds of dollars for the least expensive sacrifice of turtle doves, it would cost hundreds of dollars in today's money for the cheapest sacrifice in that temple. These people out in the country just barely scratching up a living, they lived lives that were considered unclean, however devout they may have been. And it had been hundreds of years since a prophet was last heard speaking forth the word of God. The people were praying desperately for the prophesied Messiah to come, to free them from Rome, to sanctify them before God. The nation was held tightly in the grip of Rome, and the people were squeezed still more tightly by the priesthood in Jerusalem. Their pockets were empty, their dreams were ground to dust by the greed of their rulers, and for some, their very hopes of redemption seemed to have been stolen by a corrupt priesthood. It was at this time that the grown son of one of the old country priests now captivated the attention of all of Judea and Jerusalem. And it's appropriate for us to stop here and read the account that Luke had researched in the gospel that he wrote. And I'm going to read to you and move around quite a bit from the first chapter of Luke. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abiah, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. And they had no child because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, "Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. and many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And Zacharias said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak, until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their seasons. And the people waited for Zacharias, and marveled that he tarried so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak unto them, and they perceived that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he beckoned unto them and remained speechless. And it came to pass that as soon as the days of his ministration were accomplished, he departed to his own house. And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying, Thus hath the Lord dealt with me in the days whereon he looked upon me to take away my reproach among men. I'm going to skip to verse 57 here. Now Elizabeth's full time came that she should be delivered, and she brought forth a son. And her neighbors and her cousins heard how the Lord had showed great mercy upon her, and they rejoiced with her. And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias, after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, Not so, but he shall be called John. And they said unto her, There is none of thy kindred that is called by this name. And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table and wrote, saying, His name is John. And they marveled all. And his mouth was opened immediately, and his tongue loosed. And he spake and praised God. And fear came on all that dwelt round about them, and on all these sayings were noised abroad throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all they that heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, What manner of child shall this be? And the hand of the Lord was with him. And his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the dayspring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel. And that is where Mark takes up the story. You see, it's not as if John came onto the scene out of nowhere. The folk of the hill country of Judea knew very well who he was. and how he had been miraculously born, and they knew of the prophecy that had been spoken of him. We believe that rather than being sent to study with the rabbis in Jerusalem, John went down to the monastic community of the Essenes. If the Sadducees would be considered the religious left and the Pharisees the religious right, then the Essenes would be considered the far right extremist fringe of the Jewish religion. As far as the Essenes were concerned, the Sadducees were apostate, the Pharisees were posers, and the scribes were hypocrites, the tax collectors and money changers, and all the rest were even farther from the true worship of the Lord God Almighty. The Essenes, they were the people to hang out with if you wanted people who in those days were dedicated to the true spirit and worship of God. This community, living off to themselves out in the desert, copied out scroll upon scroll of the Holy Scriptures, learning them, preserving them. We have the Dead Sea Scrolls today because of these people, and they have lasted from that time until this. They believed not only should the Gentile who wanted to become a Jew get baptized in a ceremony to indicate their birth into the true faith, they also believed that the Jews themselves needed to get baptized for the remission of their sins in repentance. They believed that everybody needed to repent of sins, to live sinlessly, and to worship God in spirit and in truth, because the Messiah would soon come. The boy John, the son of the priest Zacharias, born miraculously, prophesied to have come in the spirit of the prophet Elijah, was raised by parents who were as godly and as righteous and as reverent as any in all of Judea. Perhaps when his elderly parents died, maybe that was when John went to live out in the wilderness. Once away from the company of men, he got even more radical than that community of Essenes. He wore only what he needed for modesty and minimal protection: a leather belt, a coarse tunic crudely woven out of camel's hair. He wasted no time in hunting and trapping. He was wandering the wilderness, meditating upon the word of God, which he knew so well. And he worshiped the Creator as he went, sleeping under the sky or in some hole here or there. The Essenes kept bees. He would have been familiar with locating wild hives for the honey. He gathered locusts, of which there were 8 recognized varieties for food in Judea in those days. He prepared them, as was the custom, by removing their legs and wings and not doing a whole lot else. In Leviticus 11:22, it says, "Even these of them ye may eat, the locust after his kind, and the bald locust after his kind, and the beetle after his kind, and the grasshopper after his kind." Oh, sometimes they'd crush them up and make little locust cakes out of them, kind of like the pemmican of the American Indian. But this was not food that was served on the tables of the rich and famous. It was the food and the clothing of the poorest of the poor. No one could accuse John the Baptist of being in it for the money or for the soft, cushy job that so many in the pulpit make of it. He ate only to live, and only the poorest menu that he could find. He dressed as the most impoverished man in the region, and exactly as it was remembered that the great prophet Elijah had also dressed, in whose spirit the angel Gabriel said he would preach. John the Baptist preached 2 things, exactly 2 things. His message was clear: repentance from sin and the coming of the Messiah. He baptized the people as they came from all over the Judean countryside and even from Holy Jerusalem itself. They came with questions about their sins, and he answered them that they must turn away from their sins, do right, and turn to God. Always with great humility, John preached about the one who was coming. John made no claims for himself, though years later people would. John's whole ministry was about the day that was at hand and the need that everyone had to repent and to follow the Messiah who was about to be revealed to the world. John was among the most righteous of men. He had never so much as touched a drop of wine. He had never been with a woman. He had never fallen to any other lusts, such as the greed for money and the things he can buy. He lived a life away from the people and was almost as free of sin and temptation as could humanly be managed. Even so, John went so far as to say that he himself, though he was looked upon as a holy man, with all the answers, as the miracle boy of angelic prophecy, in whom it seemed truly that the great Elijah had returned from the dust of the centuries, a humble, fearless prophet who spoke truth to power and who so directly and clearly spoke of sin and repentance and the promises of God, even so he himself was nothing compared to the one who was coming. John the Baptist, righteous and blameless as he was not fit to untie the sandals of the Lamb of God. And Jesus said that John, this greatest and the last of the old dispensation of Hebrew prophets, the one who prepared the way for the Son of God himself, that godly baptizer out in the wilderness, was less than the least in the kingdom of heaven. I myself would not measure up very well against John, nor I dare say would any of the rest of us here in this room or throughout Christianity today. And yet the difference at the moment when Jesus was speaking that was that Jesus at that time had not gone to the cross. And when God looked upon John the Baptist, that most righteous of men, a man whose sinlessness and righteousness and closeness to God was greater than that of anyone who had ever been known. Yet still John sinned. In prison he despaired. Who knows what sins he sinned in his heart as he was off alone? Who can say except God? No one is fit, not even John the Baptist, to stand before the holiness of Almighty God, except Jesus Christ and those who are saved by his blood. Because when God looks upon us, he's not seeing our many sins. He is seeing the righteousness of Jesus Christ. John was a great man. A great man. The baptism of John was symbolic of the baptism we all truly need, that baptism of fire, the fire of the Holy Spirit of God, which is made possible when we are born again in Jesus Christ. John had only come to prepare the way. In time, the Lord chose to go that way, and when he did, though many turned away, there were also many whom John had made ready, many who repented, many who turned from their wicked ways, praying and seeking the face of God, and they found that face looking back at them through the eyes of Jesus of Nazareth. As faultless and repentant and as faithful as John was, it's only by the righteousness of Jesus that we are considered worthy to live in the presence of holy, almighty God for all eternity. And God loved us enough to make sure we could. John knew that he was not worthy to tie the sandals of his Savior, and nor are we. But like John, we must recognize the Lamb of God when we see him and point the way to him for others. Now we are carrying the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. We are preaching repentance from sin and surrender to Jesus as the Lord has chosen to come our way and to every way that we are preparing for him and to everyone. Do we see that Jesus is looking upon us, ready to snatch us out of death and hold us safe for all eternity? Do the people around us know that? The way has been made. The path is straight. We need only turn from sin, turn from death, and set foot upon that path. It's our job in our lives for those who are around us to make that way straight and to let people know that Jesus is worthy. He alone is worthy. There may be people who think that I know a lady who always, whenever something is coming up, she says to my wife, "Can you get Robert to pray about it?" Like it's going to make that much more difference if I pray. Well, it's true that the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man means a lot. I don't feel like I'm righteous. I'm just so glad that Jesus is. And I feel like because he's holding my hand and praying with me and making intercession to God that my prayers do carry, because my Lord Jesus is helping me to do that. Will we pray with him? Will we walk with him? Will we follow him? Will we make that path straight for those in our lives, our children, our grandchildren, our cousins, our second cousins, all the people we know? Do they know that we know Jesus, and if they had a chance to meet him?